Tonight, Nemo urges St. Lucians to put emergency plans in place as the hurricane season officially gets underway. Police destroy over $3 million worth of illicit drugs. Special arrangements being made for last week's 10-year-old shooting victim to complete her minimum standard examinations. And local shooting club, Club Gar, prepares to host its fifth annual Walk for a Cause on Sunday. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. The National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO, is urging St. Lucians to literally get their houses in order as the Atlantic hurricane season officially gets underway today. The season typically peaks in August and September, and it will officially end on November 30th. But the season got started early for the Gulf of Mexico. It's precisely that unpredictability that has caused NEMO to again call for citizens to take storm preparation seriously and not to wait until the last minute. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
The Met Office urged the public to be prepared as the hurricane season officially began on Friday.
As far as the Met Services is concerned and the kind of systems that we run in preparation of for the hurricane season, we are very much prepared. Our observation and monitoring system is in place. Our forecast system, it's in place because we use it all the time. And our early warning systems are also in place. As far as the expectation for the hurricane season, the 2018 hurricane season, the latest forecast or the initial forecast is for a slightly above average hurricane season.
NEMO has made handbooks available to the public through disaster committees at community level. The handbook includes tips for putting together a 3-day family survival kit.
Our message is very, very simple. Hazards could happen at any time. And therefore, we need to be perpetually prepared. That means we need to take measures prior to the hurricane season. And some of those measures that we could take is to ensure that, one, we have a family plan and every member of the family is aware of the plan. Two, that our insurance documents are in order. That means that they are valid and they're adequate. And basically to stock up on teen stuff.
NEMO also conducted a workshop for ham radio operators on Friday.
We recognize the importance of emergency communications in the aftermath of hazard events. And so what we have tried to do from NEMO's angle is to ensure that we meet with the ham radio operators on an annual basis to discuss and to firm up arrangements, to look at what is existing, to review plans and to make sure that we can have a seamless arrangement and operation with the club.
The workshop was held at NEMO's office. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Roseau coastline was teeming with police this morning. Officers were carrying out a drug eradication exercise. That exercise saw over $3 million worth of cannabis, cocaine and other drugs being destroyed. Sheffield Gillard reports.
A convoy of armed police escorted the vehicle transporting 700 kilograms of marijuana and 150 kilograms of cocaine, all with an estimated street value of $3,260,000, to the Roseau coastline where it went up in flames. The drugs were from completed cases in the High Court and Magistrates Court, as well as drugs seized in other operations over a 2-year period. Acting Assistant Superintendent in charge of Central Division, Mr. Gibson Shitoli, went through the process leading up to the destruction of the drugs.
After these drugs have been dealt with by the courts, the exhibit keeper now takes it into his custody. Now, like I said earlier, you have various stations, police stations and units who collect those drugs. So all these drugs go to the exhibit keeper. When he has sufficient amount that he decides, well, he needs to do a cleanup or a clear up in the exhibit room, he would write to me and indicate what it is that he wants to do. I will go to him, we'll discuss it, and then he will submit a list to me, which I will further submit to the Commissioner of Police. And then the Commissioner would give that approval. That same list that the Commissioner has given the approval on would be given to the Justice of the Peace for verification, and then the process will start.
A Justice of the Peace was on hand to ensure proper procedure was followed.
When an exhibit is recovered, the investigating officer, it is his duty to package and seal the exhibit. The packaging and sealing of that exhibit ensures that the exhibit is intact. Because when you go to the courts, you have to prove the integrity of the exhibit, right? And that is collecting the exhibit from the accused person, packaging it, sealing it, labeling it, and then you have to take it to the exhibit keeper. So the continuity of the exhibit between the exhibit keeper and the court system, right, would verify that this exhibit has remained intact until it is to be destroyed, right? Now, when that exhibit has been finally dealt with by the courts, the investigating officer would hand it over to the exhibit keeper, sealed in the same way and intact, right? A record will be made, and that is that same record that goes to the commissioner. The commissioner now approves of the destruction, and then we now involve the GP. The GP would verify that same list, and then we would destroy it. So that very same GP would be on site and ensure that that is done. So the GP already has prior knowledge of all these exhibits.
The operation began around 9 a.m. and took most of the day. The last time such an operation was conducted was in 2016. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Special arrangements are being made for last week's 10-year-old shooting victim to complete a minimum standard examinations. The grade 4 student of the Vidbute Primary School was caught in the crossfire of a shootout in Castries on Tuesday, one day before she was scheduled to sit the exam.
The island's education minister has described the shooting incident as unfortunate. The broad daylight exchange of gunfire left several innocent bystanders injured, including the young student. Now, Dr. Gail Rigobert says special provisions are being made for the grade 4 student to write her exam.
When horrendous events such as this happen, we always mobilize our counselors to afford the victims an opportunity for counseling. And I trust that we have mobilized the requisite resources to assist the young girl as best as we can and to make special accommodation for her to write her exam.
While relatives say the young student is recovering well, the education minister is concerned about the psychological effect on the student. She says her ministry will do all it can to assist the young girl.
This is regrettable. Yesterday I spoke with the minister and the top brass as soon as the event happened and to ascertain that she would be okay, and I was given every assurance that her wounds are not life-threatening and that she will be fine.
One individual is in custody assisting the police with investigations into the incident. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
A concerned citizen who escaped unhurt after finding himself in the middle of Tuesday's shootout is supporting the Police Welfare Association president's suggestion that police launch an offensive similar to the controversial 2011 Operation Restore Confidence to return peace to city streets. Don Nicholas has that story.
John Daniel, a customs officer by profession, says he was carrying his three-year-old son when the gunfire erupted. The only thing he could do was to lean over his son to protect him. Fortunately, they escaped unhurt. Daniel recalls the last words of the masked assailant, that he was not paid enough money.
Right to the back of us, with no exaggeration, no height. But less than 12 yards away, I heard gunshots ringing out. And I had to pull my son and just put it down low for cover. And he was shaken, tremendously shaken by the whole incident. To the point that he asked me to tell his mother, do not come to Castries or she'll die. You understand? As a three-year-old. Luckily for him, he has a father. I consoled him, but how about the children who have no father? Follow me?
Daniel is also supporting the Police Welfare Association president, who called for a similar initiative to the controversial 2011 Operation Restore Confidence. That operation led to police being accused of assassinating suspects and planting evidence along with a host of other alleged human rights violations.
I'm happy to hear that the law enforcement policeman, whether president, she posted that they might call for another Operation Restore Confidence. I believe that more stops should be made at the figures in cashiers. More stop and search.
A minibus operator who was too traumatized to speak on camera recalls being unable to come out of his vehicle when the shooting started. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And the two medical students who tended to the injured in Tuesday's shooting in Castries were honored today by National Security Minister Senator Herman Gild Francis. The two were attached to the Victoria Hospital, were in the vicinity of the shooting, and did not hesitate to run toward danger to assist the wounded. Sheffield Gillard has their story.
Senator Herman Gild Francis on Friday morning commended the City Police and the Royal St. Lucia Police Force for their efforts to keep the city safe. The minister made the statements 3 days after gunmen opened fire in the city, leaving one man dead and four others hospitalized. Senator Francis has described as unacceptable the random acts of violence that are putting the lives of innocent bystanders at risk.
We know that the police and the City Police have made strides, particularly in keeping our city safe, and our efforts will continue in this regard. After that incident, however, we saw the true good nature of our citizens to help others to get to safety and out of harm's way. I wish to commend regular citizens who assisted, and I also commend our City Police, the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, and the emergency responders.
He singled out the two medical students, Mr. Samuel Walton and Matthew Carter, for their selflessness. They administered first aid to the injured before emergency personnel arrived. A video of the two men assisting the injured went viral on social media.
Today, on behalf of the government and people of St. Lucia, I wish to recognize these two elective students at the Victoria Hospital, Mr. Samuel Walton of Bournemouth and Mr. Matthew Carter of Newcastle. They are first-year medical students of the University of Birmingham who happened to be in the area at the time. According to eyewitnesses' reports and reports of local medical personnel, these young men were instrumental in attending to the injured before medical professionals arrived on the scene. These two young gentlemen jumped to the aid of our citizens, and what they did may have helped to save lives, and for that, we are eternally grateful.
Thank you.
As Minister responsible for security, I say thank you for your bravery, and I have a feeling you will go on to make excellent doctors in your respective fields, especially after having this baptism by fire in our country. We are thankful for your intervention, and as you leave the island tomorrow to continue your journey, our country wanted to say a hearty thank you.
The two students who recently finished their fourth year of medical school were attached to the Victoria Hospital for 1 month. They recalled being in a state of disbelief on the day of the incident and underscored the importance of knowing basic life-saving techniques.
It really did catch us off guard in the moment when we were walking down the high street of Castries. Hearing the gunshots, first of all, we didn't believe it to be true. We've never heard anything like it. It's usually a backfiring car or, say, a firecracker. It's when we smelt the gunpowder that we really, truly believed the situation was more than we expected. And at that moment, when people were rushing away, as we initially did, because it's what you do, isn't it? You run away from the fear. Then we turned the corner, the police were straight in there, and we saw four or five people on the ground. These people were left alone for the minute, and we were wondering in that sort of split second moment what to do. And I think it's the training that we've had for the last four plus years of sort of to help, and it was the instinct that sort of kicked in, and we went over there and we did what anyone would do, I think, in our situation.
I hope that this can be a learning point for the future for other people to have the confidence to go in and try and do as much as they can before the emergency services can come. Although we didn't really do a great deal. If people have the confidence to do first aid in the future and try and prevent injuries in the future, I think that'd be a really important thing to take forward from this.
They were both presented with tokens of appreciation for the assistance given. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. At which point do you start when it's red and stop when it's green?
Start when it's red and stop when it's green? I don't know if you're the way wrong. I know you stop for red and you go for green.
But at which point do you start when it's red and stop when it's green?
No, you don't start when it's red, you start when it's green. But also there's a part in the Edelstein society that the red is blood. And you keep on going. When it's green, you're out.
You answer your own question already. You do start when it's red, you do stop when it's green. It's supposed to be the other way around. But there's no right or wrong about it because red means to stop, green means to go.
At which point?
Yeah.
Well, in a certain point, when you see the light red, you stop.
No, but at which point you start when it's red?
When you start when it's red,
And you stop when it's green.
Okay, when it's red, you have to stop, eh? Yeah. So when it's green, you have to go. So according to, let's say about... Not seconds, about how many inches from away from the stoplight, when it's green or when it's red or whatever, you understand? So you have to stop. If it's red, red is danger, ain't it?
Yeah.
Well, green is go. So obvious.
At which point do you start when it's red and stop when it's green?
I cannot answer that question. My apologies.
My finger is not there, is it? It's just not there. Yeah, weird. Yeah.
You wayward?
Wayward. Yeah. Mine is not settled, mine is wayward, so...
You can't say that.
I can't say that.
Boy, you see me, I think that goes for more for a female to answer that question, eh? A woman that will answer that.
Okay.
Not me.
Okay.
A woman that will answer that.
About 10 minutes before it's green.
At which point do you start when it's red and stop when it's green? That's when you're eating a watermelon. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a mother appeals for help finding her missing daughter, and the 5th annual Club Gar Walk for a Cause gets underway this Sunday. Welcome back to the DBS News World. Veteran journalist Rick Wayne has called the opposition St. Lucia Labour Party's opposition to the government considering a joint venture partnership to manage the Owen King Hospital ridiculous, particularly when the party was encouraged by the donors of the facility to consider such an arrangement when it was in power. Here is Don Nicholas.
Veteran journalist Rick Wayne recalls that at the naming ceremony for the Owen King EU Hospital, the European ambassador encouraged the then SLP government to be creative by employing the public-private partnership module, saying that it had worked well in other countries.
If that's the way Shastney's administration goes, it would mean they are taking the advice offered by the donors of the hospital.
Ironically, according to Mr. Wayne, the Labour Party is now opposing the proposed arrangement.
That's how ridiculous they are, because that is a speech delivered by the EU president, Mr. Barford, by the EU representative, Mr. Barford.
The naming ceremony was held on February 21st, 2016. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
National coordinator of the Global Environment Facility, Giles Romulus, is disturbed by the high poverty and unemployment levels in St. Lucia. He was presenting the annual report on projects undertaken by the facility when he expressed his concern. Don Nicholas has the details.
The Global Environment Facility Small Grants Program is a program that seeks to attract international funding for projects identified in St. Lucia and other small island states. The focus is primarily on cushioning the impacts of climate change, sustaining food production, and ensuring access to uncontaminated water. The programs are implemented by the United Nations Development Program, UNDP, through the partnership with the facility with funding from the World Bank. In 2017, 17 projects were undertaken in St. Lucia. 222 persons were employed. Jeff has also trained 865 St. Lucians in agriculture, marketing, business management, and diving.
These are individuals, perhaps all well known to persons in this room, who volunteered and satisfied the due diligence requirements to provide this kind of support in a Jeff SGP country office, and who over these past 6 years dutifully assisted in the facilitation of a process that was consistent in ensuring that the projects selected for implementation were relevant to the desired changes in livelihood security and well-being.
Despite a reduction in unemployment levels, Mr. Romulus expressed concern that unemployment and poverty levels are still too high.
The socioeconomic context is also important to us. We have to look at what is happening in St. Lucia. The population increase of 0.26% around St. Lucia. The GDP growth of 2.97%, our debt-to-GDP ratio at 1.3% increase, and IMF is wagging their finger at us. Unemployment rate, though decline, is still very worrying. Unemployment among the youth is significant, and the poverty rate since the studies done by CDB is still around perhaps 28.8%. Maybe it has declined, but I have not seen any statistics to prove that.
The Global Environment Facility is also concentrating its efforts on canneries. The facility is now developing the honey industry there. A number of other projects have been earmarked for that community. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
A worried mother needs your help tonight to track down her missing daughter. 14-year-old Maria Sherubin is a student of the Cicero Secondary School and resides at Casabar. She has been missing for 2 weeks now. Anyone with information on her whereabouts is asked to contact her mother at 518-6916. That's 518-6916 or the nearest police station. The Club Gar Gun and Rifle Club is preparing to host its fifth annual Walk for Cause on Sunday. Every year, the club selects a charity to donate funds from the walk to. This year, the beneficiary is the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association.
Well, what we should expect this year is actually going to have a little bit more fun. We've decided to energize the walk a bit, so we're going to have some music on the road just to keep the rhythm up and help people make those 4 miles even shorter and more enjoyable. We're also going to have this year a clock, so you'll time yourself, see how you did your 4 miles this year. So next year you can compare it and see whether you're doing better or not. And I think importantly afterwards, we're going to have some food and drink on sale here, just because sometimes when people are done with the walk, they want something, you know, good, something healthy, nutritious, pumpkin soup and, you know, a little local Creole breakfast and so on. So we also put in that in the mix this year, along with some good music. We have a very good young DJ, DJ C4, is going to be giving us some music. We're very grateful to him. But importantly, all of Corporate St. Lucia who have come on board, all the media personalities who have assisted us and supported us.
Artlists for obtaining the walk packages are Steve's Barbershop, Blue Monkey in Castries and Rodney Bay, The Bread Basket in Rodney Bay, the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association, and the Digicel Experience Store. Participants are asked to meet at the VG Roundabout at 6 a.m. and will start walking at 6:30 sharp. Breakfast will be served at the finish line. Integrating technology into human resource management. The details when we come back. As part of Reading Month activities island-wide, 18 students of the St. Joseph's Kindergarten, located on Carrasco Drive in Sanssouci, took to the neighboring Serenity Park where, for this year's Reading Month activity, they displayed uniforms of careers and occupations of characters they have read about throughout the month of May.
Today, we are celebrating career and occupation and occupations. Usually for Reading Month, we look for an activity, and this year we are celebrating careers and occupations. So right there before you, there are our little ones. They are portraying different careers and different occupations. It's important because if you can read, you will learn an education. If you have an education, you have a career. So we just want to reinforce the little ones, the young generations, and the parents to encourage our little ones to read in order for them to be good citizens and, you know, earn a proper education and a career in the future.
Pick up your book and read. And read, 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 read. Reading is sweet. Reading is sour. Reading is shocking like electric power. Reading is sweet. Reading is sour. Reading is shocking like electric power.
This event was the third of its kind for the school and took place earlier today. A three-hour workshop was held by human resource firm HRM Solutions for users of a novel piece of computer software. The Cube software is a human resource and payroll system developed by a firm to develop and simplify those aspects of business operations. The fully automated integrated system was developed locally.
Approximately 20 persons participated in the workshop. It served as a refresher for many. For others, it was an introduction to the system and an opportunity to learn about its various features and how it could benefit their businesses.
One of the things that we strive on is to simplicity and making things easier for businesses, helping them to be more efficient, helping them to save money. So the software, the training program today was only going to be about 3 hours. We also have videos that we've uploaded, very short videos that help them with learning about the product. And we also have help desk to support them if they have any questions. So it's a very easy software to learn. It's very user-friendly. If you can use Google, you can navigate through Cube and learn it. And it's important because, you know, right, one thing is that it eliminates the use of people in the business. It helps to improve communication in the organization in that employees can be notified of things in real time.
The system is designed to notify users of upcoming performance appraisals, end of probations, and other important dates.
The system also helps them in their day-to-day work lives in terms of the administrative stuff that they have to do. It provides a support and it provides a platform where you can store that information and be able to access all of this information at any point, at any time, at any location. Maybe if they're at home or on the beach and they want to process their staff payrolls, or they're not feeling well, but you know they have things to do, they don't have to come out into the office, they can stay home and be able to do what it is that they're supposed to do for the organization.
The three-hour workshop took place at the training room of the SLHTA on Friday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Time now for the weather report. And now, the usual reminder. NEMO urges St. Lucians to put emergency plans in place as the hurricane season officially gets underway. Police destroy over $3 million worth of illicit drugs. Special arrangements being made for last week's 10-year-old shooting victim to complete her minimum standard examinations. And local shooting club, Club Gar, prepares to host its fifth annual Walk for a Cause on Sunday. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night and see you next time.